What's up, everybody? Welcome to the stream. Today I'm working on some more story elements and stuff. Just little tiny details and touches. This is, once again, is a spoiler alert stream. Total spoiler alert. Don't watch this if you care about the plot and you don't want it ruined for you. You're getting back to work on the engine? Awesome. You got Emacs set up? You can build using Clang? Really? Xcode build is slower than Clang? Doesn't Xcode build use Clang? Or does it use LLVM? Alright, so the first thing I want to do is you have the option when you defeat the lightning boss of picking up the killabombs or not picking up the killabombs. And if you don't pick up the killabombs and the game saves and you die because you didn't get out of the ship in time, then I want the killabombs to still be there so you can pick them up optionally afterwards. So it's not like you ever lose out on the chance to get the killabombs. So I think one way I could try to do that would be to make it so the area has the killabombs and it's a reward item. Uses Clang. Oh, okay. Really? 2 seconds? Holy crap. You got me inspired, man, because I've been trying to shave off the seconds on my build too. That's great. I'm always wondering like about that, right? I time it from running it from Vim to like, you know, running my build. It's like a good 10 seconds or whatever, even if it has to just sometimes just run the game. It's weird. So that's probably part of it, huh? Xcode build. Slowness. All right. Well, the boss item is usually put into the boss character. Wow, that's really significant. What's up, dieharders? So Rob, what's up, man? Are you there, dieharders? I think that's in create items. It takes the area as item and puts it inside. No, that actually might be in create names. Either way, we want to make sure the player does not have the killabombs. Oh, I don't. This is a great example right here. I don't have the super bombs. And it's not recreating the item here, so I'm pretty sure it's here. If we're in the dungeon, this is where it removes the foes if we've already vanquished. Oh, it's just do hide item info. Right? I think this is where it's at. Unfortunately, I haven't got my Vim set up to be able to debug yet. So I'm going to have to do this in Xcode. I'm back in create names. And I want to set a breakpoint. here. Actually, here. And I want to make sure that the bosses haven't defeated this boss yet. Oh, shit. I thought I fixed that. All right. We got that. Okay, I just want to make sure that this bit of code is what is actually hiding the item inside the foe. What's up, Thomas? You are on time. I just started the stream, man. I'm doing good. How you been? All right, so we are hiding the item inside this foe. If alive, an AI system is alive. All right, so we should be stealing the area item. Actually, no, maybe not. Maybe it just takes... Okay, so we want to go into do hide item in foe and say if this is the lightning boss's dungeon room, we don't want to hide the item inside the foe. So what would be, I'm trying to think of a good general way to make this logic really well so that if I ever do this for another boss in the future, it would kind of like work well naturally. A lot happened, but you're still rocking it. Same here, man. Lots have been happening. It's good to see you, man. You been making music still? So this is obviously, it's a boss room where it's a, I guess this is a really special case because it's a boss room where it saves, it automatically saves for you right after this because there's a story element here. So this is kind of... Yeah, this is kind of like special case. So if we have boss and this is the ship, I guess. I can't really think of a better way to put that. Or pattern equals K, pattern boss 8. Scratching vinyls? Right on, man. Nice. He's got plenty of needles, I hope. Don't put item in lightning boss. All right, let's set that breakpoint again. And we'll go step inside this function. Yeah, the updates. Oh, there's lots of them, man. So many. Game's getting closer and closer every day to being released. Even though it's not there yet. And it'll be a while. But it's getting closer. Day by day. Okay, so we're gonna step into this do hide item and foe, and we should be hitting this. If Hasbits, K flag boss, and pattern equals K pattern boss 8, return false. So there, it's going to skip over this time, and that means... Oh, it just puts it on the ground. Not cool. Alright, we need to make it so it's a reward item. Oh, that's a good way to put it then. If we're this logic, we are not going to hide. If Hasbits, K flag boss, and Hasbits, flags, K flag, reward item, then return false. Nice, right on. Yeah. Well, one good thing is I'm never going to show the very end of the game, so you'll never get everything spoiled. I won't show it on the stream, but I am doing a lot of spoiler alert typey things today. I'm working on some pretty pivotal elements of the game where, I don't know, you might not want to watch. Okay, so we want to set the reward item flag here, so we'll go back to world. When it's creating, just create dungeon Z. Yeah. When it's creating the dungeon Z and it's setting a boss, here it is, pattern boss, style Z. Alright, this is a good place to put it, because we're in the ship dungeon. Contains key A2, ship engine, pattern ship, lock doors in before boss room. We also want to make the boss item a reward item. If contains flags, is that right? Yeah, flags, K flag. Boss flags or equals K flag reward item. So once again, I need to check this again just to make sure that logic still works. And then let's hope that makes it so you have to fight the boss to be able to get the item. You have to deal with it. Not contains, this has bits. Oops. I'm kind of rewiring my brain to think in Vim, and it's causing me to really code slower for a while. I mean, some things I'm faster in Vim, some things are slower in Vim. Debugging is like impossible in Vim so far. Unless I get some plugins, but apparently the plugins only work with GDB, which means I'd have to use GCC. Not sure I want to do that. Maybe there's some kind of Clang debugger. Okay, so once again, do hide item info. If has bits, K flag boss, and has bits, K flag reward item, return false, good. We're going to skip over this. Yeah. All right. And now, the item's still on the ground. Okay, why is it on the ground? We'll go to create items. Oh, does it have to have secret as well? I guess so. Yeah, it's a reward secret. Okay. Hopefully this means, yeah, all right. So the item's not on the ground. It's a good start. Cool, yeah. It did drop the bomb in the middle of the screen right when but it was kind of like dropped it right on me. It's kind of weird. Oh, it did the item platform thingy too. So, item platform, we don't want it. Where does it put it? It's not collision system. My name's item platform. It creates it. Where does it create it at the beginning though? Just create item platform. Do item platform? Maybe. All right, so I guess, should we check for flag secret here? Or do item platform? I guess if the item, we only should do the item platform if the item is a life container, I guess. All right, that works. That would be this get item. Okay, if this get item is not equal to, or if it's not constants is life container. Okay, let's check that again. The great Houdini's last name was Weiss? Nice. Really? We might be related. That would be sweet. Dude, thanks for sharing that. All right, so it didn't recreate the item platform. I already picked up the killer bombs. Thank you. Okay. So we need to turn off killer bombs. You didn't change, did you? What if I try and write this? Damn you! I thought I'd fix that. I guess it didn't lose focus. Let's try and fix this. So if I load my vimrc, I got some code that's supposed to automatically reload when it loses focus and stuff. I guess we could try adding focus loss to this. Let's see if that works. What's up, HD? All right, man. Happy errand running. Okay, so what was I doing there? Taking off the boss. Shift A. Backspace. I guess I could have done change, find. Yeah, let's undo that. Go back to the beginning of the line. Okay, if I go change, find one, no, that changes all the way too. There some simple way I can jump to the one and start changing? I guess I could go F1 and then change. Or wait. Change the end of the line. I don't know. Still learning Vim, man. My brain hurts. Super bombs, wanna take those away? Why do we not have those? I thought those were in here. Weird. There's two bombs. Ay, ay, ay. We drop the bombs on the ground. hadn't picked it up. So it saved it as an item I could go pick up. And then it came back in. Like I'm hacking the whole thing here, man. There's probably a better way to do this. Ah. He drops a triangle bomb, yeah. What's up, Lime Studios? Die Harders! Okay, so, tricky. Which way to do this? I feel like I'm doing this wrong. I'm like hacking the system by making it so this particular item dropped from this boss works differently than every other item dropped from bosses. There might be a better way to do this. Cutscenes! I'm working on cutscenes! Spoiler alert! Spoiler alerts! Okay, so let me skip through this dialogue. I'm pretty sure there's two of these items here. It's pretty clear there are. Can I pick them up twice? I don't think I can pick it up twice. That's kind of cool. I thought that reward item already had to have this. Ay, ay, ay. Yeah, you might want to skip this one. This is a total spoiler alert. The page layout. Oh, you mean watching the stream page layout? I'm using this software. Oh, Die Harders. By the way, I'm using this software called Game Show. This might be of value to you. I think you use... Do you use Windows? Yeah, Lime, thanks for stopping by, dude. See ya. Oh, just the Twitch page? Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I haven't touched that in a long time. I should go update that. But this is kind of worth knowing, too. This Game Show software is pretty cool. You might be using OBS. I'm using OBS. I used to use OBS. But I switched to Game Show a while ago, and the one thing I like about Game Show is it's able to keep my voice in sync. OBS, I could never figure out how to get it to keep my voice in sync, which is always kind of annoying. I'm like, I would watch a video and be like, oh, damn, my lips. I look like Milli Vanilli, man. Milli Vanilli. It's the Milli Vanilli stream. Alright, now this should... If I try and write now... Oh, it allowed it. Allow it! So we have no super bomb container. Ah, so many little things wrong with this. Maybe a better way to do this then would be to make it so when it creates names, oh yeah, Twitch is freezing. Oh yeah, that might be your OBS settings, because what usually is happening to OBS and Game Show and other types of things like that is that when you start your game up, the software that's basically turning your screen, yeah, it might not actually be Twitch. It might actually be OBS, because what's happening is you're on your end of it, when your streaming software detects that it's going into the game, there's a hell of a lot more pixels and things like that for it to try and crunch into video, right? So what happens is your actual KBPS, your rate that you're streaming at, goes up a lot, but only especially on the very first few frames of it trying to deal with your game. I might be part of it. I don't know. But you're saying it's, even though it's windowed full screen, yeah. It might be it. I don't know. Maybe that helps. Right? You don't see anything wrong, probably because you're right at the source, right? You're because it's just an increased bit rate. So you're already really close to your source, but like viewers that are around the world or viewers that are somewhere else, right? Because of that huge spike in the KBPS, that's why their Twitch glitches out. And that's why it wouldn't on your end, because your KBPS to yourself or to your own node or whatever is, it doesn't have to hop very far, you know? No, people aren't seeing different stuff. It's just that the bit rate goes up and down. Right. So watch, look at my bit rate right here. It's changing a lot. Yeah, we're all streaming from Twitch. We're all sending our data to Twitch, and then the data gets sent from Twitch to them, right? So it's just that there's a spike in this in how much data it's sending, and that's why it probably glitches out for people. So what you can do to solve that is basically just go into your output settings and change up how it renders your video and stuff. Like, you basically just want to use really optimal settings. And I found these particular settings right here to be really important. So it passes this. I think it's possible to do this in OBS as well, where you set a maximum rate for your bit rate, and you set a mac and you set a buffer size as well. And I think if you're using, I think OBS has these exact same settings somewhere where you can specify extra x264 command line options. So you're at 1250. Yeah, here's some of the things, right? Setting your average bit rate's important, but you also want to be able to set your max rate. So it never ever goes above this, right? Because if you just all of a sudden, if your stream is just suddenly trying to send people 4,000 or something like that, it's going to be a problem for them watching you. So yeah, there's this. There's frames per second. You can set that a little lower. You can go at a width and height that's like a little smaller. You can try and use faster encoding, things like that. But I think the really the main important things are these. And then also you want to make sure your settings are right for Twitch, because Twitch wants you to have strict constant bit rate. And also keyframe aligned. Yeah, I think these two things are really important. And then your keyframes has to be the number of the number of frames per second times two. So if you're streaming at 15 frames a second, you have to have your keyframe at 30. If you're streaming at 30 frames a second, this would be 60 here. And this is all on the tw this is all this is these important things here are on Twitch's info page somewhere. It'll warn you if you're not. Yeah, it's only some people. Yeah, it's only some people because some people have a weaker internet, you know? How you been, man? Oh, you already have all those settings? Oh. Right. So what did I change so far? I'm thinking this might be a bad way to do this. You been good? Cool, man. Nice, dude. It's good to hear. Actually, I'm gonna stash this. Yeah, every day is kind of hard, right? Yeah, I think I do like 4 or 5 a week, and that's a lot. All right, man. Yeah, see you, Thomas. Later on, dude. Yeah, there you go. Let's git stash this. Right? Let me sure I only change. Yeah, just two things. Let's git stash that. And I'm going to try doing this a different way. Because I think that was just not the right way to do it, man. Man. Basically, what I want to happen is you fight the lightning boss. And he'll drop the super bombs, but if you don't pick them up, it should basically just the area should create the item if you didn't get it. Right, a time limit for content creation? Yeah, I know what you mean, man. It's kind of cool, right, to try and get see what you can get done in 2 hours. I've always enjoyed that. It's like, it's cool because first of all, you can be creating, but second of all, you're also kind of doing marketing at the same time. You're sharing your game with other people, and it also provides a lot of challenges, right? Like, what can I get done in 2 hours? And it's also motivating because it's like, wait, I want to be able to actually do something significant that other people might be interested in. Yeah. Yeah, and you get a share. It's cool, right? It's kind of tough to get over that initial bit of streaming. The challenge of like talking and coding is kind of hard, but it's easy to make art and talk. All right. So yeah, we'll go to create items. And we'll set a breakpoint here. But not use it just yet. Oh, co-host? Yeah, that'd be cool. All right, so we'll fight her, make sure that... She drops the killer bombs. It does this segue. Yeah? I don't know how that'll work. Okay, it still has the item. That's good. But it should have saved me right here. So if I close... Oh, that makes sense why it didn't save with the item before. So yeah, if I close here... This is the exact situation that I want. It's going to load up, and it's not going to have the item. Yes! Talk about your sex life and jet-setting lifestyle, man! Hell yeah! Everybody wants to hear about that! I want to hear about that. Help me escape from my own normal life. Okay, here's where we want to set a breakpoint and make it so the game just puts an item here if you don't have it. Your Hollywood parties? Yeah. And also in create names. When it gets to here, oh, it's probably just gonna skip it. Okay, let's see what happens. All right, so it's getting into create names. This is create items. What function is this? Why is this? What the hell? It is create items. So it hasn't created names yet. Oh, it does create items first. Ah. Okay. All right, so I guess the best way to do this would be to put it into do hide item and foe, because this is where both of these are going to be calling, right? Create items goes and says if do hide item and foe, it returns and it doesn't create the item. Okay, so we've got do hide item and foe. And this little bit. So we don't want it to do an item platform here. So we do hide, do an item platform if it's a life container. And do hide item and foe. Yay. So world get boss status for level Z is defeated. Then we're going to skip that enemy. So we'll make do hide item and foe smarter. All right, so if has bits, so this is a boss room and world gets status for this level Z. This level Z is constants get level Z for area pause dot Z. If it's a boss room and we've defeated this boss already, actually, this goes in this logic right here, because this logic is the thing we're talking about. If it's boss and it's not a life container, it returns true, but only if the boss hasn't been defeated. There, this is starting to feel like a better commit here. Whoops. All right, so yeah, if it's a boss room and this item that the boss has is not a life container and the boss status is not already defeated, then we're going to hide the item in the foe. Whew. All right. It's kind of a long path to get at one tiny little thing, but I think this is a better way to do it than the other way I just did, which was stashed as a git commit, git stash, an uncommitted dish git stash, a mustache. Okay, so we've got some breakpoints. Let's make sure this works. Already got the breakpoints. We are going to hit the breakpoint right at create items. So we're going to step into do hide item and foe. It's going to be true if it has the boss. It's going to be true that it's not a life container. But the get boss status. What level is he? 10? Good. Get the boss status. What do we get? Didn't say. Damn you! Xcode! But it did skip it. Which means it must have been defeated. Alright. So we can return out of this method, and it's that should be false this time. And then do item platform should also be false. That's good. Okay, let's run that. And then, yeah, so this should also, it should already have vanquished this. Yeah, cool. Okay, we can turn off all our breakpoints now. Let it run. And good. Okay, good. We have the item on the ground. Yes. All right. Now let's make sure that when it comes back after the segue, it's not doesn't have two items all of a sudden. I don't think it does. Okay, what happens if I go out of the room and come back in? Good. It looks like we only have one item. And it's still there. If I go out of the room again and come back. Good. Okay, now let's make sure that that works. Given that we haven't defeated the boss yet. Okay, we haven't defeated the boss, and super bombs we shouldn't have. Cool. Okay, back to the now we're back to the state before we fought the boss. There should not be an item on the ground. And if we defeat the boss, it should pop out of her. Good, it did. If we run this segue and come back to the room, oh man, does this mean it's gonna create the item now? It did, damn it. Ay, ay, ay. What's up, Henko? A bud for a bud. Thank you. Thank you for sharing this virtual bud. Okay, it just... that's kind of okay, though, right? Put the item on the... Because it, well... Thank you. Thank you, Henko. If I had one, I'd be drinking one right now. Sounds kind of good. I guess we could put some logic so that it doesn't... It doesn't duplicate. It doesn't create an item if it's already in its list of items to that were saved items. Wait, did that? Yeah, okay, so this, there are saved items. It loops over the saved items, creates items. Huh. Does area already have a like a has saved item function? Nope. We can write a little function for that. Static bool. Wait, is this already? Ah, it's private, right? It's a private member. Okay. Don't create the item if it is already a saved item. And I think this should only happen if the area item, if it only has one area item. So we'll loop over the saved items, and if I dot item equals item return. This is if we don't create the item if it is inside a foe. Don't create the item if it is a reward item. This is just show that the item is let's just show that the area has hidden stairs. Okay, now set a breakpoint here just to make sure that this does work. This is kind of worrisome because I feel like I shouldn't need to do this way. Right? Once you create the item, I guess it does make sense, kind of. Really, the only situation where this would happen is if you're segueing. work that time, but wait a minute. So why didn't it, hold on. Why didn't it work? Gosh, I'm checking over all this so much because this is such like an important element of the game. If I mess up how boss items are dropped, you know, that's a pretty worrisome thought. So I got to make sure this is done right. But I'm curious because when it creates the item from killing the boss the first time, it doesn't recreate the item, I don't think. Let's check that. If I segue and come back, does it create two items? I don't think it does. So why does this one work and I have to write this special code? It does create two items. Okay, so this is totally necessary. All right, I guess I'm not gonna worry too much about this anymore. Because I think this will only happen in pretty rare cases where the item is a saved item and it's not being hidden in a foe. I guess I'll go chest some other bosses. All right, so let's check this out. Run it again. There's the item on the ground. And yes, here's where it's detected that there's only one item here. It should have dropped it, right? I guess this is kind of a good check. Actually, does get item do that already? Oh, no, it doesn't. Okay, yeah, this is a good way to do it. If this area only has one item and it's already on the ground... Oh! One last check here. Damn, gotta start this over again. If the item type... This is a saved item type. What are these again? Item status. Not K-none. Not unscanned, just created. K-created. Okay, so if I type equals item status, K-created. Then return. Okay, once again, gotta check this, and then check it the other way, and then triple check it, and then quadruple check it, and then check the commit. Important stuff here. Okay, kill the boss. Drops the item. Hit the breakpoint. Still just one item. good. We'll skip this dialogue, go outside of the room, come back. Also neglects to create the item because it's already on the ground. Good. This is actually a pretty good piece of code, I think, over here. Okay, and we've saved the game there. So we can go ahead and run it again. And this time, the boss will be defeated, but we still haven't picked up the item. So it creates it on the ground the first time because it recognizes that it wasn't a saved item or anything. Oh, and that time it had never ever been a saved item. So it didn't break or anything. But this time, if I leave it on the ground and go out, I guess I've never run into this problem before because I always pick up the boss item. Okay, so that time it didn't have to stop itself from creating it, because it created it in a different way. It didn't create an item status thing. An item status is only created when a boss drops the item. Okay, it's starting to make sense why I've never had this problem before. Alright, I think I'm comfortable now turning off this breakpoint, and I want to see the status of what I've already done. Good, this is a pretty atomic commit. Basically, it's now do hide item and foe is a little smarter. And create items is smarter as well. Okay. I'm liking this. So, to make sure this is all working, I'm going to go and check this with some other bosses. Let's go to dungeon 1. Make sure dungeon 1, we haven't already completed it. And also, I want to make sure I don't have life container 1. Good. And also, I'll take off life container 3 so we can check dungeon 3. All right, let's do this. Oops. Hold on. Go back to this dungeon. Busy day. Oh, cool. This is right where I want to be. What the hell? Oh, is invincibility on? No? What the hell's going on with this? Did I break something else? I can pick it up, but the top hat can't. What happened here? Another bug. Dude, I'm just swimming in bugs. Some of these items I can't pick up. Alright, so it allowed the item to come down. What's up, Blood? What's up, buddy? How you been? Alright, so if I go out of the room... Wait, am I having this breakpoint on? Let's make sure this is on. Go out of the room. I can't go outside of that way. You're good? I'm good too, man. Things are going great. Right, it still handles this the same way by dropping it down. And if I save right here like this, go back in that room, it doesn't have to anything to do with this. Because it's never a spawned item or whatever. Yeah, good. So it drops it down from the ceiling. Do our normal stuff. Okay, good. So this new code did not affect that at all. Let's check dungeon 3 as well. Yeah, so what's new, man? What you been doing? How's the company? So this item also is not created from dropping from an enemy, so it's never gonna hit that breakpoint. It's just gonna be fine. Okay, good. This is a good check-in. No problems with that. But I'm having some weird problems with picking up items now. Alright, I'm comfortable with that. Let's get rid of these breakpoints. Check this in. It's only one file. You found an artist for your silly games? Awesome. Company's doing good. Right on. A huge new system. Wow. Nice, dude. Right on. Sounds like you come to a milestone. You've reached a milestone, my friend. Congratulations. What are you going to do to celebrate? A bottle of champagne, a beer, play some video games, something like that. So will this work for other stuff? Yeah, I think so. Don't hide the item in a foe if already defeated. And don't create the item on the ground if it's already a saved item. Whew. Achievement unlocked. Yeah, right? Achievement unlocked. System done. Whew. That was a big one. Okay, so that's good. If we go and fight the lightning boss, and we kill her, but we don't pick up the killabombs, and then we die getting out of Songbringer, we still have the choice of picking up the killabombs again. So, that's good. But now I'm kind of worried, why is it not picking up the items? Your everyday items. What's up with that? Let's check that out. Back here at this point, 141. Oh, not 141, 131. Ah, should I switch back to Vim? Okay, I'm not really debugging, I guess. Oh, but I will be in a second. Okay, there. Why can't... Oh, there, it finally picked it up? That's weird. I know, very specific bugs, right? Yeah, they're tough to find. I got another one on my list that I'm afraid of. I don't even want to work on it because it's so hard. Like it's only happened to me like in super rare cases. It's where some dialogue initiates between some characters and the dialogue completely stops all your input. You can't do anything. It's basically that it's locking. The game keeps a lock count. So when dialogue happens, it locks the input. And then when the dialogue stops, it unlocks the input. So the lock count goes from 0 to 1 to 0. I think what's happening is that it's locking twice, so that it goes from 0 to 1 to 2. And then that whatever's locking it that second time is not unlocking it. That's probably what's going on, but it's like so hard to catch this really specific situation. Anyways, it's a scary one. So should I just work on this now or finish this particular thing later? I guess I'll investigate this really quick. I'll give this like 5 minutes. Why is it not picking up the item till after a second? Let's see it again one more time. When did this start happening? I guess I've been working on really specific bugs all week. It's probably been this week, I guess. Okay, now it's not even picking it up at all. Oh, there. Was that okay? Is that a really just specific position then? Think it might be just an actual really, really centered. Oh. I did change one thing with the collision system this morning. Oh, wait. Is it that? In the collision system, I changed the way is intersection works. Could have been that. That's it. Okay, well, that's fixed. All right, good. I guess this was how this should have been. But it's kind of weird. I thought this was fixed that way, but I guess I broke that. It's a curious situation, but that really wasn't that important. I was trying to fix something, but it broke too much else. So I'll just put this back the way it was. These are all greater than or equal to. What did I just do? Don't know what the Z command does, but I accidentally did it. Yeah, all the collisions rectangular. Yep. Totally rectangular. I just kept it that way. I wanted it to be really simple and really old school feeling. So I think rectangular collisions have really helped to keep it kind of feeling old school in a way. And I've kind of like worked around that. I've always made art look like it fits pretty well into a rectangle, but sometimes trying to make the art look like it's not a rectangle, but yet it still kind of fits into a rectangle. So I think it works for Songbringer, but for the next game I might do polygons. Okay, let's get on to the next bug. When you're getting out of that room, when you're fighting the lightning boss, it shouldn't have the door locked. You have the switch already to get past that door anyways, and the lightning boss shouldn't be appearing. So why is it like locking the player? Why is the door locked already, basically? So we'll go back to that point. What if happens if I write here? Hold on. Yeah, this didn't load. So this should be an error. Oh man, I can't figure out how to get Vim to load, to reload automatically. That's kind of a sucky thing. You want to donate some modules? Right on. Right on. Okay, so we have defeated. Yeah, we've defeated this boss. And I want to skip through most of this dialogue. So let's go. Oh, I can just delete this line. And then the story element, I can just comment out almost everything. So we'll add some semicolons here. Oh, except for this. So when someone tells me that I'm on a commercial product, I always say no. Right? Spawn any Captain Tusk, Hollow in. We'll skip this stuff too. Yeah, I want to skip all this. Just so this story element happens really fast. So I can debug this faster. All this dialogue. Yep, it just does this. So all it does is shake the screen. Okay, so we're ready to do this and have it be faster, debuggier. All right, and it's going to be, I'll just run it now. Hopefully this is the right position. Probably is the wrong position. I don't think I moved the player yet. No, okay, so. Back to 6, 5, 10. Okay, yeah, so now we got the countdown, the other story elements and stuff. So this door is open, but if I go to this next room, the door is going to be closed immediately. Probably because there's a lightning boss bomber. Actually, yeah, let's check that really quick. If we go to foes, here it is. And we find Lightning Boss Bomber. And we don't have that foe there. Let's run it again. You can never know when someone will come demanding stuff later on. Oh yeah. I know. Yes. Yeah. Okay, that was not it. Even though it didn't have the boss. So what if we take the flag locked off? Yeah, sometimes when people try to commit like free, they help out free of charge. They're actually not helping out free of charge, you know? It's actually doing more harm. It is good because, like, you have to go back and either fix their code, figure out their code, that kind of thing. It's just this door. This door. Fine, it's open at first, but this door, amongst all these doors, is the one that's closed at first. Okay, I think I know where it generally is. Before I fix that, I think what I'm looking for is 8 statue. No. Statue dungeon, maybe? Hey, what's up, Anoa? Yo, Anoa, I got your email. Sorry I haven't replied to you yet. But yeah, I've been meaning to. I'll get to that today. Yeah, we could figure something out, Blood. Twitch Prime? Is that like Optimus Prime? I think Twitch Prime is just when you have an Amazon Prime account and they give you just a like a hat next to your name. And oh, and it also makes it so you don't see ads, so that's pretty nice, right? Okay, so let's the eighth statue. Create statue tile. Oh, and then, yeah, there's also other cool stuff, right? Free games. This is for get any entity data statues or statue dungeon. Okay. So let's find statue. There we go. All right, so let's go flags fade out. And see if that makes it so the statues look good. Nah, that wasn't it. Oh, it might have been Statue Dungeon. Lots of little bugs, lots of little features still being implemented in Songbringer, lots of story elements I'm creating. That's mainly what's going on here. Story, story, story. So if I go up into this room, it should fade. Yeah, that was it. Statue Dungeon. All right, cool. Fades that out nicely. Those little pipes or whatever, they fade out. Okay. Also, Gargoyle should have that. Okay. Cool. So those will fade. Oh, also the gargoyle entity. Oh, and there's eight gargoyle. Okay, so now we don't want to do this gargoyle. Want to do this gargoyle. Oh, it already has fade out. Okay, so that one's already good. All right, so that's a good little change. The only thing that's in life that's free is cheese and a mousetrap. Cool saying, man. Oh, that's sweet. Oh, hey, so while you guys are both here on the stream, I wanted to ask you something. So next week, basically all year for Songbringer, I've been promising everyone that everybody's going to be able to play the game in 2016, right? So people have pre-ordered the game like even all the way back in like last March, and they were expecting to play it by like last March. So people were, I feel like I kind of duped people because they might have pre-ordered the game in February, expecting to play it in March or sometime in 2016. And now they're still waiting. So I wanted to ask you guys about the idea I have here. So what I'm going to do is, I know I'm already going to do this, but I want to see if there's maybe you guys have any ideas on how I could do it tactfully or do it better. So I want to upgrade I want to upgrade all the people that pre-ordered the game at the $16 version. I want to upgrade them for free to the $32 version, but based on a cutoff. So, like, if you pre-ordered the game, like, before June or something like that. So, let's say you pre-ordered the game in January, February, March, April, or May of 2016 or earlier. Like, even in going all the way back to the Kickstarter days in 2015. If you pre-ordered a long time ago, basically, over 6 months ago, you're going to get... And you pre-order at the $16 level or below, you're going to get a free upgrade to the $32 version because I feel like those people have been waiting too long. So I want to do that tactfully. You know, I want to send out some emails like starting next week and like do a little Kickstarter message and say, hey, everybody, I'm going to upgrade everybody that's been waiting a long time so that you can play the beta version if you want. And if you... Let's say you're still waiting for the full version of the game. You want to wait till it's completely done. Then all you have to do is just not play the game. You can get you're still going to get your Steam key and you still have the ability to play the game, the beta, if you want. But so basically you'll have your key at this point. So do you guys see any problems with that plan? Am I thinking wrong? Could this be offending anyone? Is it fair? Yeah, those people, exactly. Those people in the, right? Those people that supported the game all the way back in 2015, these people have not been able to play the game yet. And I already have their money. You know what I mean? They've already paid me money for this game. They've already pre-ordered it. So I think this is a pretty fair thing, right? I'm basically giving them the game. I'm giving them more than what they paid for. But still, they paid for the game, and they were expecting to play it this year. So, because it's not out this year, that's why I want to do this. What about the people who paid $30? Didn't they feel ripped off? Well, yes. Okay, so that's a good point, right? If you let's say you pre-ordered the game at the $32 level during the last 6 months, then I'm going to give all those people the option of getting a partial refund. So, so let's say you paid $32. The $60 version no longer available. Maybe. So if you pre-ordered the game at $32 and let's say you did that this September or something like that within the last 6 months, then you'll get a special email saying, hey, would you like to be credited for $16? Or would you like to have an extra copy of the game? And there's really not that many people that ordered at $32 in the last 6 months. It's maybe like under 100, definitely under 100. Under 50. Definitely under 50 people have ordered at $32 level in like the last 6 months. So we're not talking about too many people, but yeah. It has to be fair for them too. That's a good point. So I think, the way I would handle that is to make sure they have the option of either being partially refunded or they get an extra copy of the game. Uh-huh. Why the last 6 months? Because there's some people... Okay, so there's some people that have ordered the $16 version recently, and I'm talking about upgrading only the people that ordered. Oh, I guess that makes sense. Yeah. So if somebody didn't, good point. If I guess that solves that problem, right? If somebody, this is only counting for people that ordered 6 months ago or more, right? So it really doesn't really apply to people that paid $32 within the last 6 months because they, you know, no one's getting anything special there. The people that paid $16 in the last 16 months or 6 months are still not getting upgraded either. So I guess it doesn't matter. That's why the 6 months. I sound like I'm kind of confusing myself here. Maybe I should actually make a little drawing about this. Extra copies would be nice. Would be clearly a giveaway key for people to discover it and maybe do more purchases. Not the first 6 months. Well, okay, so I want to do, well, let's just draw this out so that it's really clear. Okay. All right, so we've got all the way back in 2015 is when the Kickstarter was. There's 2016, this latest year. We're talking about May of 2016. People have been waiting for more than a year. Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm trying to do is like make it so people that have waited a long time, but I also want to include people that ordered at the beginning of 2016, like up to like March-ish. Because those people have almost waited an entire year and they thought that they were going to get to play it in 2016. And there's a lot of pre-orders from the beginning of 2016. So, so there's 2016. Let's put this also at May-ish. And so there's a lot of people that ordered at like from the Kickstarter that ordered at like $128. They've already end up, you know, those people have already been, they've already got their copy of the game. Exactly. As a year as an example. And then the $64 people have also been fulfilled. The $32 people have all been fulfilled. But there's some $16 orders, right, that haven't been fulfilled. And then all the way, and in 2016, we have tons of $16 orders and also $32 orders. Wait. Oops. Yeah, like up to March, right? So the $32 have already been fulfilled. Even the most current $32 levels have already been fulfilled. But I'm talking about these $16 orders from like a certain cutoff point, right? Let's just call that May of 2016. If you ordered before this time at the $16 level, you're going to get upgraded for free because you waited a long time, right? But people after this, if you ordered the $16 after this, then you're still waiting for the game. And there's no need to reimburse or like partially credit people that have ordered at $32 here, because these $16 orders are still waiting anyways, right? So these people that have paid $32 in the last 6 months, they paid so, and they're getting what they paid for, right? They're getting to play the game now. But, and so that makes it fair for these guys that these $16 orders haven't been upgraded for free. Exactly. And the $32 guys, these guys are not feeling ripped off because they already have keys. They're already playing the beta version. And it's fair because these guys haven't been upgraded. Yeah, there's 128. There's people that paid $512 for the Kickstarter to design their own NPCs. Yeah, no, really. The 128 one was to get a poster. So you got this Songbringer poster, and you got your name in the credits as your gold backer. So your name's in gold on the game and stuff like that. Yeah, their picture wasn't a monster. Cool. And so wait, so Anoa Net, how does this sound from your perspective? You just ordered the game for your friend, right? You ordered a $16 copy. Are you cool with this? Are you cool with people before May 2016 getting a free upgrade? Cool. All right. Yeah. Nice. The extra key is useless, right? Yeah. Okay. Good. So yeah, if you're happy with that, and you just ordered one of these $16 versions, then I think this is a pretty good plan, right? This way, the people that have been waiting a long, long time, they're gonna get to play the game if they want to. They can play the game. They're gonna get their key, and these people we'll still be waiting, and but it's really that they've only been waiting a little while anyways, so I think this will be cool. Just a nice way to thank people for supporting me. You know, you guys have supported me a long, long time ago. You deserve a copy of the game. Yeah, exactly, right? Sometimes it can be more exciting because you don't know what you're gonna get. You might glitch yourself into a wall and be like, oh, the French version's a mess, is it? Yeah. Is it just you're talking about the translation is a mess? I imagine it probably is. Oh, right, yeah, localizations wise. Okay, yeah. Cool. Yeah, I don't think the French version has been updated in a long, long time. I forget who's doing the translation there. But yeah, it hasn't been touched in a minute. But I'm not expecting people to be keeping their translations like all perfect or anything, because it's really, you know, you can just do it once the game's done. You don't have to keep updating your translation. Should I disable that translation for now and just make it so it always does English? Because the French version's kind of too out of date. I could just take out the French file and then it would just do English for now. All right, cool. I'm happy with that. All right, the door being stuck. That's right. Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Vlad. I think I'll do that. I'll do some RTL support. I think the newest versions of Cocos 2DX already have it built in too to their bitmap font stuff. So it's probably just a matter of upgrading Cocos 2DX, which shouldn't be too bad. You found in the mechanics is the controls. You tried to set it to ZQSD. And when I had said Z for up, the game didn't let me. I know what you mean. Yeah, I know what you mean, Anoa. Yeah, let me. Okay, I'm gonna actually set a. I'm gonna do a Trello item for that right now because I've noticed that too. Basically, what's happening is it's the game already has a binding for a certain letter or a certain key. And then it doesn't allow you to bind it again, but that doesn't really make sense at all. The game should just allow you to bind it anyways. Even if you are rebinding the same key twice, it should just let you do it rather than trying to force you to not do it. Or it should at least say that key is already bound or something. So let me add a trail item for that. I'm just gonna try doing always allow rebinding the same key. That'll kind of be more intuitive, I think. And now I'll make that a really high priority item. Yeah, so that happens to me too. Like I'll be starting out a game and I'll be like, I want to redo my bindings and I'll be like, shit, I can't do this one key. It's because it's already bound to something else. So yeah, that should definitely be shouldn't be that way. All right. Okay, Okay, so I'm back here. I'm trying to make it so this door is open at first. And I think it's not doing it because it's not like, it is, it's a high priority item. It's super high priority. I think that particular door is not recognizing itself to be already open. So I think it's in door system. Already open. Oh, look at this. It's the before boss door. Oh, this totally makes sense now. It doesn't allow you to already open the boss, the before boss door. But it should only do this if the dungeon type or dungeon has the flag of the before boss door, or else this is it detects that this door type. So let's go to door component. Is there some way I can know this is a before boss door? I don't think there is. There's no type. I guess it would have a door flag. Something like that. Let's make it a before boss door. That'll work. I'm sure of it. I think that these before boss doors have flags. Do they? Wait a minute. Constance. K door. before boss door. it's funny to say that. Oh yeah, there's stay open and there's shake. And both of these happen for boss doors, but not for the others. Right? So the boss door. Boss door has stay open and shake. Okay, we'll check for those flags. That works. So we can know that this is a before boss door, not by checking it this way. This is super lame, but by checking it this way. It's a Hodor. Hold the door. So if it's not a boss door, if not, or hasn't bits, door dot flags, K door stay open. If not a boss door, there. It's a hoe, like a hoe, like digging into my garden hoe. Man, I'm starting to get hungry. Yes, look at that. The door is already open. Hold the door. Hold the elevator. I'm trying to get to the elevator, man. Hold it for me. Yay. Okay, that's working good. All right, let's make sure that this doesn't break the way that the boss doors are supposed to work. I'll need to test it in like dungeon 2 maybe. And we should have dungeon 2's switch 2-8. Oh, like a bros before hoes ho. All right, so this opens up. But if I go off the screen and come back, it should open again. Good. And the same thing should happen if I go, wait. If I go away from this, yeah, but if I go back up in this room, defeat this guy. Stop the emotes. Don't stop the emotes. It's so lewd. Don't stop believing. Don't stop believing. Oh. So we go back here, and good. It doesn't automatically open up the boss door by going back in this room. So this little fix does not apply to boss doors. Good. That's a better way to detect a boss door anyways. And that's a pretty short commit too, right? Control Z. Oh, I need to now check if it's working with, if I undo this change right here with set flags locked. Oh, somebody followed? Thank you for the follow, follower. I appreciate it. Set flags. Yeah, yeah. We gotta turn those off to make sure it still works. Okay. That's here. I think I can just go undo. I already had all this change. Oh, maybe I did this in Xcode. Okay, whoops. There. So I'm setting flags. Well, let's do one thing at a time here. Hold on. Let's just make sure that adding the locked flag works. And we want to be back at 6510. Munch. Thank you, Munch. Munch, Munch, Munch. Buy the 32 and buy the 512. Don't you want to get your own NPC in the game? Everybody wants their own NPC. Okay, that works. And if I put this back, so it has the Lightning Boss Bomber. Whoops. It's a 2048 one. Nobody bought that. Nobody did the 2048 or the 1024, but those were options on the Kickstarter. Both, there were two people that did the 2048, but they were both fraud. Yeah, some fraudulent backer tried to back my project, but Kickstarter was like, nope, I'm not allowing it. I will not allow it. This is fraudulent. Yeah, it works. See this? It's working. Shit, yeah. Okay, I'm gonna undo the change to this. Did I do this in here? No, damn. X down, X down, X down. X, 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 X. Right, and then over here, we should have, there. That's all we changed, just that. Yes, bad boy, bad boys, bad boys. What you gonna do? Fraudulently back that Kickstarter project. Bad boys, bad boys. What you gonna do? Try and rip people off for things on Kickstarter. Yeah. Uh-huh. So that's a pretty small change, right? All I did was add these flags fade out for the statue things on the ship. And then this tiny little change. I think this is good, right? One more little bug fixed. This door should open. Okay, it's gonna run the whole story element here though. Spoiler alert! Close your eyes! Alright, and if I go out of this room, the door should still be okay. Good. Okay, now I want to test one more thing. If I do that again, and I try and go out of the room. In fact, I should be able to get out of the room right here. Wait, no, I can't. Oh, because it hasn't finished the story element. That works, I guess. Yeah, let's do this from the beginning then. Let's go, well, first I'll check this in. Fixed. Before boss door being closed on ship. All right, and yeah, if I go back and fight the boss again, F1, R0, still learning Vim. There we go. Now I should be able to fight the boss again. I want to make sure I don't have the killer bombs. Good. Okay, let's make sure this all works. The whole sequence works. All right, we come into this before boss room, or this boss room, fight the boss, cheating the beater really quick. Oh, I'm almost dead. Yep, she drops the bomb. Jib is an item. Yes, he is. Spoiler alert! She steals. Captain comes in for some dialogue. It didn't put down two bombs, but at least the bomb is there. We go out of this room and the door is okay. Yes! Alright, good. So that bug is fixed. And we should be able to walk our way out of the... Okay, so what's the next bug? Hold on. What's the next thing I gotta do? That one's off the list. Oh yeah, this story element. This would be the next thing. Don't save the world pause if you're counting down, but I don't think that matters. And then some more story elements. Story elements, story elements. Okay, good. Everything worked just fine right there. So if I save the game right here... What happens? I'm gonna reload the game. Oh, I was in the wall there. What if I was to go back to... Oh, it runs this element again. And it saved me there. That's okay. In release mode, it wouldn't save your position, right? It still does this, even though we're like not there. But that's good. We want this story element to happen no matter what. If you're on the ship and you beat the boss and somehow you saved... In release mode, basically in release mode, it would have saved you at the... Actually, I should test that. Let's test that. Let's go into release mode. I'm gonna have to do this from Xcode. Let's get that compiling. And we'll start at, say, 6-4. So we'll walk into that boss room. And turn that off. Okay. Now super bombs too, shouldn't have. Maybe we do. Maybe we do have these already. Yeah, let's find out what happens if we did already have it. Okay. So I'm getting close to being done with the stream because my stomach is rumbling. But I'm going to test this one last thing. I'm going to go into release mode, fight the boss, defeat the boss, then close the game just to make sure. Actually, what I'll do is I'll go a few areas south or whatever so that I'm, and I try and quit the game. I'm going to quit the game in the middle of this mad scramble. You're trying to get off the ship. And I'll quit the game there, and it should still start me back in the boss room and still do the whole mad scramble. I know it's really long on the stream, and because it has to recompile the entire release mode build. So yeah, when I'm not streaming, when my computer isn't eating up so much CPU, crunching video and stuff like that, my build's a lot faster. Everything is slower when I'm streaming. Wah, wah. But yeah, it's usually a hell of a lot faster. Something in my pipe is weird. Which pipe? Which pipe are we talking about here? Almost done. Oh my god. I wish Jai would have been out before I started this whole game. Oh yeah, single. Yeah, I know. They're sweet, man. Unity builds are awesome. When you have basically what we're talking about here, if anybody's watching this stream, you're like, what are they talking about? We're talking about a Unity build. It's the technical term is a Unity build. It's where you basically put all of your CPP files into one. And that makes your build a hell of a lot faster. But there's some drawbacks. One of the big drawbacks in Xcode is that Xcode is stupid about Unity builds. And if you put all of your CPP files into one, Xcode won't know how to do jumping and auto completing or any of that kind of stuff. So that's a big drawback. And secondly, the other drawback is that your static variables can clobber each other. So since you're having everything as one compilation unit, your static variables are all there in the same file technically. So if you name a single static variable inside a CPP file or C file, you name it like verbosity, for example, and then you have several different files that all had the static variable verbosity, you meant that to be a private thing in that file, but since you're doing a Unity build, that becomes an error. So there are some drawbacks to doing a single compilation unit, but if you can get away with doing a single compilation unit, it is hella fast because C++ is slow as shit with how it compiles headers, basically. Robert, which engine do I work with? I'm using the engine called Cocos 2DX. Oh, right, the autocomplete works, but it's like, yeah. It's just really slow. That's right. It's just really slow. But it's so slow that it basically, it's like it shouldn't even, it basically disables it for me because like it's so slow. I'm like, I can't even use it because it's that slow. Oh yeah, forward declarations. Yeah. Okay, so let's see what this all works. This is gonna be the last time I run the game for today's stream. But I'm going to go through and test this out in release mode. Sometimes it's hard to fit everything in a line. You're doing a low poly game? Sweet, man. Oh, right on. Good luck. I hope you find the answer, man. All right, good. So because I'm in release mode, it starts me at the beginning of the level. I'm just going to run through in God mode and cheat to get to the boss room. Oh, that's the one. Okay, that's not supposed to be like that. I like low poly games. Yeah, salad dogs. Salad dogs brings up a very good point. Psychologically, once you start doing Unity builds, you do try and get so obsessed with build times that you might spend too much time trying to optimize your build, which is kind of ironic, right? But I've been there, I've done that. I've squeezed out a couple seconds on my build time, which I think is kind of worth it, right? If you do squeeze out a few more seconds and you do a build like 40 times a day, isn't that kind of a win, right? As long as you don't spend a couple days doing it. It still takes 2 seconds to compile? Oh shit! Even though it's not, you're using Xcode build anymore? Right? Yeah. Right, Blood? You and me both. That's why I want to switch to Jai. Here's where I have a crazy bug sometimes. Right, so we're in release mode. Get a little health there. Alright, I'm just gonna cheat to kill her. Are there any localization files in the retail files? Yes, there is. So if you want to tweak the French localization, you can totally do that. You just go into the data game folder. I'll show you that here in a second. All right, so here's what I want to test. It saves the game. Or it already did save the game for me right here. I'm gonna quit. And I'm gonna go run the game here again here in a second. But yeah, let me show you that folder, Anoa. It's in, if you're in your Steam folder, it'll look like this. You'll have assets, Linux, Mac, and Windows. Just go into your assets, data. Oh, it's just assets, data. Yeah, and then it's strings, FR for French. So yeah, you would edit this. And if you send that to me, I'll put it in here. Linking is lightning quick. Oh, weird. Right, slow. Twerk a file? Yeah. Did I say twerk? I think I meant tweak. All right, so this time when I run it, it should start me in the boss room and still do the story element. And then the next thing I'm going to check is to go out of the boss room, be like halfway through getting out of the dungeon, and save. And it should still... Oh, shit. Okay, there's a bug right there. It should not have started me right there at the beginning of the dungeon. So let's fix that really quick. That's in set... Valid something. Twerk the French translation, man. Twerk it. Twerk it. Twerk it. That's right. Print it out and twerk it. It should be some street talk, man. Set player position. There it is. Set valid. I typed set valid. This is why I'm switching to Vim. All right. Move hero. Here it is. So it allows you to... Okay, this is where it's basically... restrict what world positions the player can start at in release mode, right? It's trying to comment things a little bit better. There we go. Yeah, so if you... Wait, no, this is just where it positions the player, damn it. This isn't it. No, this is now it. It's world set pause or something like that. Okay, but I guess this can be, this looks a little cleaner like that anyways. It's like set, it's in game, set, let's just go to game, set, pause, load pause, here it is, load pause. Here it is, it's forcing the start position. And all right, we need to put one more piece of logic where if it's – Let's grab this area. Okay, this would be, this makes more sense to me if we go, if not has bits refill or entrance, or it's the sword, or it's area it up, well. Yeah, area.pattern equals k pattern boss 8. And then two of those. There we go. What's up, Biker Dad? What's next after I release this game? I'm going to be working on making this game better. Yeah, I'll probably continue following up on Songbringer for at least 6 months after its release. But after that, after it's all said and done and the game's all the way out and all good and stuff, I'll be starting on Songbringer 2. And I've decided I'm going to do that even if Songbringer fails. If Songbringer is a complete flop, which is still a possibility, you never know, I will continue to make this series anyways. I'll find a way. I'll either get a temporary job or something like that, a part-time job, or like do some like quick contracting work to build up some funds so I can make the next game. All right, so let's make sure this works. In release mode, it restricts your position to places that have refills or entrances or the sword Z or this particular pattern right here, pattern boss 8, which is the boss pattern that we should be at. So this should allow me to start there now. Shouldn't be at the start of this dungeon. Followed by Songbringer Kart, Songbringer Puzzle Battle, Songbringer RPG. Wait, it already is an RPG. Damn it, it didn't work. All right, why? First of all, what's our saves.txt? Oh, it's saved at the wrong point. Well, that's part of it. Oh, that's because it ran this story element. Okay, so this should allow now. Oh, set this 6510, and it should allow the player to start there. Lego Songbringer, yes. It's already kind of pixel art, right? You might as well be Legos. We already got big blocks. Songbringer Go? Yeah, totally. The AR version. It's augmented reality Songbringer. You can go and find... You can find Jib everywhere. Good, so it allowed me to start here in release mode. So what would happen if I were just south of there? Actually, let's run it. Run it. Oh, that kind of sucks. If it's just south of there. And the play, oh, it's not going to save the player's position. Okay, so that should be all right in release mode. It should never, ever set the player's position. Wait, did it save the position in the first place? Ay, ay, ay. What's this game about? You might not want to watch if you're into Zelda games. This is, I'm showing some spoiler alert-y type stuff. This is a Zelda, this is like Zelda 1, but it's procedurally generated. So this whole game, you enter 6 letters to start it up. What's up, Proton Gaming, by the way? Yeah, you enter 6 letters, and those 6 letters generates an entire Zelda 1-ish kind of world. And so if you enter the same 6 letters, you get the same world. And if you enter some different letters or whatever than you're used to, then you're going to get a world that you've never played before. So that allows you to share worlds with friends, or there to be like wikis about a certain world. But because it will, no matter what platform you're on, they will always generate the same world. So it's just basically, it's a way to make Zelda-ish games, but have them be completely procedurally generated. There's lots and lots and lots of logic and layers and stuff like that going into making a world feel really good and feel really Zelda 1-y, but still be procedural. The holiday traffic, man. Ah, jeez. Spoiler alert. This is a spoiler alert stream. Okay, so if I go here and like save, even like in this room, save and quit, it shouldn't allow me to save that point. And good, it did not set my position. And so if I restart again here at this point, it will still keep me in the boss room and make me watch the scene again and stuff like that. Because you gotta get all amped up, man. You gotta run off the frickin' ship. It's about to explode. It's going down. Abandoned ship. Good. It started me there again. Alright, so that's gonna be it for today's stream. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody. And as always, I really appreciate everything you've all done to support this project. This project appreciates you. I appreciate you. And, we'll catch you all next time. I'm going to be working on some more story elements probably the rest of this week. I mean, this weekend and stuff. And yeah, there'll be another beta update coming out this Sunday. So thanks a lot, everybody. Cheers, everybody. Have a good one.